I don't know how many people here know who Verisk Analytics is, so maybe I give you a two-minute overview of my company. Before Monday, we were about a $1.8 billion analytics company. We help various industries, insurance, healthcare, credit card analytics, and one of the new areas, supply chain risk, in assessing risk and using analytics to help make better business decisions. As of Tuesday morning, according to some newspapers, we're a global data analytics giant. We acquired on Tuesday, we announced the acquisition of a company called Wood Mackenzie, based in Edinburgh, Scotland, who is a leader in upstream analytics for the oil and gas and mining industries. So we're really excited about teaming up with Wood Mackenzie. And I just got back last night from London, so it's about dinner time for me. So I'll try to keep up my comments to a half an hour so that I can get dinner. So I'm not going to figure out how to do this. All right, so I wanted to talk about the role of the CIO with three stories. And the first one is around risk management, and specifically information security, which is the theme here today. And then second, I'd like to talk about big data analytics. We all hear about big data. That's what we do at Verisk, so I can hopefully share some insights as to what that is and what it means. And then finally, the evolving role of the CIO and what it takes to really use that role to provide executive level leadership. So as a backdrop to today's discussions, I'm not a security expert, but I deal with it in my role, and you know, it's an important part of our overall risk management at Verisk. But I thought I would tell the three kind of scary security threats that we face today. You know, so really tee up maybe some of the conversation that will happen after me. And then I have, after the three, I've got the one doomsday scenario that I think is just fun to talk about. My intent is not to be comprehensive, but to give you a flavor for some of the big risks that are out there in the information security space. So I want to talk about zero-day exploits, data breaches, and cyber espionage. Regarding zero-day exploits, they're about slipping through the cracks that you never saw in your infrastructure. All software has flaws. But sometimes the bad guys find them before the good guys do. And when the bad guys do find them before the good guys have no time to prep. That's why there's zero-day exploits. You have no time to respond. And I'll give one example, which one of the sponsors here, FireEye, had identified back, I think it was last April, where they identified a flaw in Windows Explorer, Internet Explorer, and it got to the point where the Department of Homeland Security issued a warning for people not to use Microsoft Internet Explorer until it was patched. That is scary. And through this zero-day exploit, the attackers would get control of the computer. So it was really serious. And what's remarkable about this is that, you know, Microsoft was taken by surprise. You know, we have a major product, Internet Explorer, that was affected by a major U.S. company. And these things can come in and really have big impact. You know, these are similar to, you know, attacks that have been launched by Chinese cyber spies, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But this is how serious that, you know, these kind of things can be. And there's also fears now, given that attack, that the cyber criminals are out there having built up a stockpile of these attacks that are geared toward Windows XP. Windows XP, as you know, is a retired operating system. It's being used pretty pervasively still. And Microsoft has not issued any security updates, or they say they're not issuing security updates. You know, based on the attack last April, they did patch Windows XP kind of out of necessity, but how many times can this continue to happen? So these zero-day exploits are powerful and potentially, you know, very damaging. The second area I wanted to just talk about is data breaches. And one of the big threats here, you try to lock down your environment and you do everything you can, but sometimes the one of the biggest threats is people that use the same passwords everywhere, right? So I use a password on a weak site, and a criminal's able to get my password, then they can take it to a stronger site and just log right in, right? So it, you know, just because you're protected doesn't mean that you can't have someone inside your network. And the impact of credit card breaches has been, you know, on the rise dramatically over the past few years, where criminals are stealing hundreds of millions of credit card numbers and data on credit cards. So I thought there I would bring up three, you know, very prominent breaches. And the first one I showed a little bit here. Last December of 2013, moving into January, you know, Target was infected by hackers that compromised their payment card systems, and it affected over 100 million Target customers. You know, the criminals took contact information, name, full names, addresses, email addresses, telephone numbers, and the impact was huge to Target. You could see, you know, what the impact to their stock price was. They're in blue, by the way, and the overall market is in orange. But it took the stock over a year to recover from pre-Thanksgiving levels. So that's a long-term shareholder impact. And they just released in their annual report this year that the cost of this breach to them was $162 million. Last month, just a few weeks ago, Anthem, formerly known as WellPoint and the second largest healthcare insurer, had a data breach where what was stolen was names, addresses, birth dates, social security numbers, employee histories, sort of a treasure trove for ID theft, you know, ID thieves. 80 million current and past customer data was affected. And the last one I'll bring up is a very big news last fall, Sony Pictures. You know, November 24th of last year, computer screens at Sony were hijacked by the Grinning Skull. And you know, there's a group called the Guardians of Peace that said they basically said, we will release information online if you don't meet our demands. Well, within days, internal Sony Pictures data was on file shares. Again, social security numbers, scanned passports of executives and actors, internal passwords, marketing plans, financial information, and four unreleased Sony movies were posted. There's 6,800 employees at Sony, 40,000 other individuals that work with Sony, that get some payment from Sony, were all in dire risk of identity theft because of this incident. And rival studios have a detailed blueprint of Sony's plans going forward. Pretty scary stuff. The first 3 months of 2014, there were 254 breaches identified. I think this was a Verizon report, and that was up over 200% over the prior year. So these breaches are increasing in frequency. And what's worse about it, and here's where we can do something, Verizon identified that only 1% of the databases were encrypted. So once you get someone in your network, the data's there for the taking. And you know, the attackers are getting better, and they're getting faster at a higher rate than we are able to defend against. So it's a pretty scary scenario. And I know that, you know, with Verisk Analytics, a lot of the, you know, proprietary data that we hold this is one thing that keeps many of us up at night. So the third area was cyber espionage. And that, according to Verizon, was the biggest growing area of cyber crime. It grew three times over 2012 to 2013. And this is where foreign countries are looking to steal American secrets, copy them, and implement new products in their own factories at much less cost than they could buy it from America. And it was a really threat to our competitiveness. There was an interesting, if anybody saw it, an interview with James Comey, the director of the FBI, was on 60 Minutes. And one of the things he said is kind of really shocking. He said there was two kinds of big companies in the United States. Those who have been hacked by the Chinese, and those who don't know they've been hacked by the Chinese. So it's a scary commentary from the head of our FBI. And they asked him, it was kind of a little bit of the funny part, is he said, are the Chinese good at this? And he said, they're not really skilled at covering their tracks. He said, they're sort of like a drunk burglar. You know, they kick in the front door, they knock over a vase, and then while they're walking out with your television set. So the point is they're prolific. You know, the strategy is we'll be everywhere all the time, and there's no way you can stop us. You know, they're not looking for credit cards or personal information. What they're looking for is trade secrets, which is just as damaging in many ways. So they're looking for useful information so they don't have to invent things. And they're learning about how to negotiate with American companies by getting our trade secrets. So it's a multi-dimensional problem. When they asked Comey what the cost of this kind of breach or cyber espionage, he said it's really impossible to estimate, but it's likely in the billions of dollars is the impact. So again, it's scary stuff. So those are the three scenarios I thought I would throw out there that we all think about and deal with on a daily basis. But then there's a doomsday scenario too, and we talk about cyber terrorism and cyber war. You know, computers are control just about everything these days. Drinking water, electricity, emergency services, and there's a real fear from our national security officials about an attack on our critical infrastructure. Digitally disrupting the operations of dams, power plants, water distribution, the financial network where a lot of us work in that world, transportation systems. The worst case scenario is where these systems are taken over, water's released from dams, flood cities, cities grind to a halt with no electricity. I don't know if anybody was in New York during Sandy, but I was downtown. It's not fun, and that was only a few days. But banks, subways cease to function. You know, clean water and food runs out very quickly. So these are, there's the idea that cyber war terrorism is with the intent to cause personal harm. It's kind of speculative right now, but the point is it's out there and it can happen. The Stuxnet worm in 2010 is a clear example of cyber sabotage, where Iranian nuclear plants were damaged, through use of cyber techniques. So those are a few kind of food for thought for everybody as we have our panel discussions this afternoon. Today's theme: cyber security as business strategy is something we need to consider, and we need to think about what all these threats are to our environment. So that's what I had to say on IT security. Maybe we'll move on to some more happy thoughts. So happy thoughts. It's spring is coming, baseball's here, and we have data analytics. And I don't know if anybody saw, there was an article last, I think it was June, in Sports Illustrated, where the headline is introducing your 2017 world champion Houston Astros. Well, I don't know if anybody follows Houston Astros, but prior to this coming out, they had three seasons in a row where they lost over 100 games. They are at the bottom of the league. So the story starts out with a gentleman named Sig Menjdal, who was got his undergraduate degree at University of California, Davis, in mechanical and aeronautical engineering. And in the summers, he made some money by being a blackjack dealer in Lake Tahoe at some seedy casino in Lake Tahoe. But what he learned in that experience of being a blackjack dealer is humans don't always make decisions that serve their long-term best interests. And you know, even when equipped with knowledge, experience, and data, you know, even when you understand probabilities, you don't always make good choices. And you know, I'll give an example. So blackjack is a game of probabilities. It's a probabilistic game. For a combination of cards, what you're holding, what the dealer holding, there is an optimal action. Okay, and it's these optimal actions are designed to improve your chances of winning, or what I like to think is improve your chances of losing less. So sometimes the choices are obvious, right? And we love it in business when we have those choices, but they don't come that often. When you're dealt a 10, you always hit. It doesn't matter what the dealer has, you hit a 10. But then there's other situations where your intuition doesn't want you to do what we know is the right, you know, right answer. And I'll give an example. When you're holding a 16 and the dealer has a 7, what do? You hit. That doesn't feel right, right? And when you have $100 sitting on the table, it feels even less right. So people make the wrong decisions, because the right thing to do when you're holding a 16 and the dealer has a 7 is to hit. So what Sig ended up, he moved on, got two master's degrees from the San Jose State in cognitive psychology and research. In 2003, he read the book Moneyball. And does anybody read Moneyball or see the movie? The only thing I'll say about Moneyball is it is the perfect movie. So I went with my wife and we both enjoyed it. For very different reasons. She just loved watching the actors. I forget who was in it. But in the middle of the movie, she leaned over to me and she said, "What's a walk?" I said, "Now's not the time. Just look at Brad Pitt." So it was actually the perfect movie. But Sig read Moneyball and said, "Hey, I want to get in on this baseball thing." So then, meanwhile, there's a guy named Jeff Lunau, who also had a very interesting background for baseball. He went to the University of Pennsylvania and had a dual degree in chemical engineering and economics. He went on to Northwestern to get his MBA, and then was hired by the St. Louis Cardinals, who is one of the best franchises in baseball, consistent winners in the league. And he was hired to run their front office. And his job in St. Louis was to keep a healthy team healthy. And he took that job in 2003 when Sig read about Moneyball. In 2011, Jeff was hired by the Houston Astros. He brought Sig over, and his goal there was to defibrillate a dying franchise. And just to give you some statistics, Houston won the World, or was in the World Series. They didn't win. They were in this World Series in 2005. Then they went on a dramatic downfall. So they had a decline. In 2011, they lost 106 games. 2012, 107 games. 2013, 111 games. And their attendance was half of what it was during their run. So they're really, before the 2010 season, they were rated as the worst minor league system in baseball. And you can see how that played out over the course of a few years. So Lunau and Medjdal kind of put together a decision tree where they had a starting point at the bottom of the tree of 56 wins. And then they had the top of the tree, which is a sustainable world championship team. And what they wanted to do was every decision along the way, they wanted to make sure that they were thinking long term. So basically what they were looking to do was hit on a 16 versus a 7 every time. And what they wanted to do is, baseball players, there's hard statistics, like how fast a player is, how fast they throw a baseball, you know, things like that. But then there's a lot of it that's soft. Work ethic, swing development, how is the swing being developed, you know, the injury likelihood. And what the two men wanted to do, which is the interesting part, is synthesize the qualitative data that they had with the quantitative data. And it's really an evolution of Moneyball. Moneyball is really focused on statistics. And what these guys wanted to do was incorporate good scouting, good data about the soft parts of a player, but then turn it into an analytic. So you have information that's collected by scouts, health, family history, the mechanics of the swing or the pitch, and one's personality. And the goal that they had was to take all this information and produce a metric to make a, you have a decision on a player. Do you hit or do you stay? And you know, I'll give one business example. So one of the areas I have responsibility for is supply chain. And in when you think about risk in supply chains, companies have spent a lot of time optimizing supply chains. And what that means is optimizing for cost. Offshoring for to get better pricing, single sourcing to leverage up a supplier, keeping low inventories for low working capital, just-in-time manufacturing. Stuff arrives today, we assemble, we ship tomorrow. Well, all that introduces risk, right? So what we're looking to do is, through some of our data, is help companies risk adjust those decisions. So you can't decide to source a part in a, for a supplier in Thailand without risk adjusting that. So just because it's less expensive doesn't mean it's a better decision. So what we're looking to do in a similar way is take a lot of data, qualitative data around geopolitical risks, human rights and societal risk with some hard data, like the probabilities of a flood. So we could take that and come up with, you know, here's your answer. So that's where I think analytics is going, taking some of this quantitative data, qualitative data, and helping make decisions. So what the guys do in Houston is they run regressions of all this data on a database going back to 1997. That's when college statistics were digitized. And the result that they have is a numerical projection. What's the production number of runs expected out of a player versus their pay? So there's always sort of the trade-offs. And then the front office makes decisions largely based on the result, even when it feels wrong. So the result, so Houston, they didn't finish in last place last year, but what their goal is not to be competitive. What their goal is to get to championship as fast as possible. A lot of teams can kind of hover around that, you know, 500 mark and never really get past it. That's not their goal. Their goal, they said, it doesn't matter if we lose 100 games in 2013 if we win a championship in 2017. So right now their farm system is rated one of the best in baseball. They've got top prospects. This guy George Springer had an amazing May last year. He had 12 home runs in his first 45 games. Then he got injured, but it was the first winning month they had since 2010. They've got a great young pitching staff. If anybody knows, have anybody heard of this guy, Jose Altuve? Well, he won the batting championship last year. He's a Houston Astro. So the other point is, they said it doesn't always work out. Sometimes you hit on that 16 and you lose, and it would have been better to stay, but that's not the long term here. We want to make long term decisions where the probabilities work out so that it's in our long term best interest. So that's what I have to say about analytics as it relates to baseball. I think it's an interesting story, and it'd be interesting to see, you know, how the Astros continue to make progress. Now finally, my last story is a personal one, and it's about the role of IT and the role of the CIO and how it's changed over the past 10 years. Over the past 10 years, there's been pervasive access to technology, to the internet. Mobile technology has really changed how we work and how we interact with each other. And there's sensors everywhere, you know, and we're moving into this phase of, you know, the Internet of Things or the Internet of Everything, where everything is giving off data. So IT is really kind of changing its whole profile, and, you know, where we were maybe had an identity crisis years ago, it's dramatically different now. So we've moved from a back office operation to a core operational imperative in companies. You know, in strategic importance, IT is just as important as finance, marketing and sales, and the role of the CIO has changed with that, and you know it's about being operationally excellent in technology, but also integrating technology into the fabric of the business. You know, a lot of times we talk about the business versus IT, you know, and IT is the business. We got to stop saying there's the business and then there's technology. They are the same these days. And what you need to do, and what I've learned, is you got to lead from a business perspective. You know, you need to understand the business as well as anybody. There's no reason why the CIO or anybody in technology, you can't really take a deep understanding of the business like the CFO does. I looked at the book. There's a great book out there called The Real Business of IT, if anybody's seen it, by Richard Hunter and George Westerman. They talk about how you need to change the way you even talk, right? So they give a great example of an exercise machine. Well, the typical IT guy would look at an exercise machine and say, well, here's how fast the wheel can roll, the treadmill can go around, or you know, here's what you can measure. Here are the different statistics: this speed, that speed, up, incline, decline. But really, isn't the value of the exercise machine the user's performance? It has nothing to do with all those mechanical aspects. And we measure so many mechanical things as we look at data centers and speed of machines and number of transactions. That's not really what it's about. So it's really changing the way you think. And think about always think about business outcomes first, then show value for the money. One of the things that Richard Hunter says is you never, ever, ever discuss costs without talking about quality of service. Okay, so you want to have the right services at the right level of quality at the right price. So I always sit with my business folks and give them options. Yeah, there are different ways we could deliver service. Some are very expensive, some are less expensive, but they have different quality and different different service levels. So then you also want to position IT as a long-term investment in business performance. And you need to use operational measures. It's not about projects and timelines. It's really about what you're delivering to the business. And again, Hunter says there's no such thing as an ERP project. You know, it's really a project about finance or process or things like that. And I'll give an example of always looking at business outcomes. One of the things I did when I was at Verisk is we acquire a lot of companies, which means we acquire a lot of infrastructure. And when I got here, I described our environment as islands of infrastructure. So I talked to our CEO about taking a path of data center consolidation, and it's easy to get caught up in number of servers and different technology aspects. But the way I presented it was not about that. It was actually twofold. One is, in the information security perspective, every island's a whole, right? So, and we can invest a lot more in a couple robust centers than we can in 20 islands. So part of it was, this is a risk reduction activity. The other part of it was, there was cost synergies. I mean, we're a large organization, so having 20 different land closets, colos, data centers is more expensive than two. But the way I laid it out, not in terms of cost reduction, what I did is I analyzed or helped with my finance team. I looked at what the EPS gain was by consolidating our data centers. So we could give back to shareholders if we consolidate our data centers and reduce our risk. I also did an analysis based on our margins, what the incremental revenue would need to be to get the same bottom line gains. That was a real impact to people. If you went to our business heads and said, well, would you like to sign up for this much more revenue over your already aggressive targets? Or would you like to consolidate data centers and let me kind of take it over? And it was an easy conversation. So I think, with my story, through activities like that, I was able to gain credibility. I also raised my hand and said, "Hey, I'm interested in getting involved in running some of our businesses," and I proved that I could do it because I was running IT like a business, and it's a pretty big line item in our budget every year. So I was able to prove that. I got involved in some activities with some of our business units. And then when Scott Stevenson took over as CEO in April of 2013, he asked me if I would take on running one of our new business areas around supply chain risk. And that's one of the activities I do, along with still running our email system and protecting our networks and doing the IT things that I always did. So that's my story. And I guess I'm right on half an hour, but I don't know if I have time for a question or two.
Sure. Short questions. Going once. Okay.
Well, I think my card is out there, so if anybody wants to contact me, please do. I guess we have one question. Nope.
What are your best conversation subjects to get other business areas involved with in order to start a conversation on different projects?
Yeah, so I'll use my data center consolidation example again. So Verisk Health is one of our big units, and one of the ones that we wanted to bring into our overall consolidated infrastructure. And we had our president of Verisk Health had a requisition on his desk to buy some significant amount of storage that attached with an Exadata box for Oracle. And so he called me up. He says, can we discuss this? Because he was being diligent. He wanted to understand what he's signing for. It was a big check. He wanted to understand. So we had a meeting. We talked to him about different options around storage. And could you put it inside the Exadata box? Could you put it attached? And you know, the different scenarios we had. And then in the end, he said, okay, this is helpful. It makes sense. And I said to him, I said, Joel, we just spent a half an hour talking about infrastructure when you could have been out meeting with a customer. So that's how I had that conversation. I said, yeah, let me handle this. We'll make sure you get the right storage. This is something you don't need to worry about. So it's more about value add, you know, that you know, his time would have been much better spent with a customer. And he was doing the right thing. You know, he was doing what he needed to do, but it was not the right thing for our company. Again, if you have any questions, shoot me an email. I'd be happy to correspond. Thanks.
Thank you, Perry. Now I'd like to introduce the moderator of our first panel, which will discuss technology plus company growth, increased security challenges. Please welcome Tony Cole, Vice President and Global Government CTO of FireEye.
Thank you very much, Jim. Appreciate that. And if we could actually have our other panelists come up, please. Val Thomas, Senior Vice President and Chief Information Officer at Lincoln Tech. James Eichmann, the CTO of Billtrust. Tony Trauma, the Director of Security at MicroStrategies, Inc. And Nathan Horn Mitchum, Vice President and Information Security Officer at Provident Bank. So thank you all for joining us today. So first of all, I'd like to thank Perry. That was very interesting. So I love getting out there and talking to business leaders. And you may have heard my title is Global Government CTO, but as a corporate executive, I talk to customers from everywhere. So because we all know government is here to actually, you know, protect and provide for our society. So and not the other way around. So it's very interesting to actually spend a lot of time with companies out there as well. Our panel today is to talk about technology and company growth. Is an increased security challenge. You know, that's a fascinating area to me. I'm retired from the U.S. Army in cryptography and cybersecurity and spent many years at Symantec and McAfee before moving over to FireEye. And it's a fascinating place today. Perry gave you some, you know, a few headlines and some stories, you know, about what's taking place in the world today. And it's something you as business leaders really, really need to understand. You know, that we live in a changing landscape, you know, that you know is going to continue to evolve and mutate on a continuous basis. There's been a number of studies in the past few years about, you know, it's possible that, you know, the advent of IT and how it's been adopted has actually potentially sped up evolution. So, you know, records that were set when kids were in typing classes, you know, 30, 40 years ago are just crushed today. I mean, just absolutely crushed. And my kids are grown. And I will tell you when, quite grown actually, both of them out in the workplace already, but when they were still had phones that had the numeric keypads, my son could actually type a text message faster on that than I could with a keyboard. So it just kind of shows you, you know, the changes they're going through. Now when you take that component and you add cybersecurity into it, you know, it's a very scary place that we live in today. So FireEye is focused on these targeted attacks and the incident response to these targeted attacks. And it's really fascinating to watch the shift from way back when, you know, when we first started interconnecting systems across the board, and we started to see some of the concepts around viruses that were first discussed in the 1940s, before we had computers really, so start to come into being, where a vulnerability was found in an operating system. Once that vulnerability was found, it was widely discussed. So some attacker actually created some malware with it, bundled it up, turned it into a virus, a worm, or a Trojan, and launched it on the internet, and we'd see compromises on a broad scale. So we still see that today, but in a much lower level because it's not as impactful. You as for those of you CIOs out there, so if you've got 1,000 nodes that get compromised by a broad scattershot attack, and those nodes are suddenly actually serving up spam, maybe for illegal drugs from Canada, so or some type of click-through where an attacker is making money when someone actually clicks on that link that's sent them, that's a problem, it's a challenge, you know, it's an embarrassment for your company and something you need to solve. However, today, instead, we're seeing attackers actually go through, identify vulnerabilities in code in the hundreds of millions, if not billions, of lines of code out there around the globe, identify a vulnerability in it, create malware, so, and then based on social media and all the information we put out there, so actually target one single individual to get access to their assets behind that. So think about that, you know, here's a broad scattershot attack, maybe 10,000 nodes on your 100,000 node enterprise that's compromised. You're doing a distributed denial of service, so you're attacking somebody else's network. You gotta shut that down. There's liability there, there's risk there, there's embarrassment there in the press. But think about, as a publicly traded company, one single targeted attack again against your CFO 1 week before earnings, and all they do is compromise that one system. Nobody's ever seen it before, there's no signature for it, so that one attack gets through and suddenly they have access to the CFO's system a week before earnings. That can be much more devastating, that single targeted attack, than that 10,000 nodes that were compromised. A major, major issue. This is where we are today, and we see, you know, continuous problems building in this area around critical infrastructure. Perry mentioned Internet of Things coming to being. You know, that's a really scary one. Some analyst, IDC, says 50 billion interconnected devices in IoT by 2020. Today there's only like 10 billion connected devices. Security's not being added as a component of all those embedded systems, and that's terrifying. So the attacker continues to shift their tactics and methodologies. So when you buy a company, even when you lock your company down, you get added risk by bringing in that additional company. That's one of the things that we want to talk to you about today. So without further ado, I'd like to jump into the panel and just actually have each one of the panelists, starting with the other Tony, Tony T. So go down the row and actually just talk about it, introduce yourselves and talk about it from your perspective for a second.
Great, thank you. I'm Tony Trom, I'm the Director of Cybersecurity Solutions at MicroStrategies Inc. We're headquartered in Rockaway and in Denville here in New Jersey. And we've got a regional office in Malvern, Pennsylvania. We specialize in infrastructure, services solutions, custom code, voice solutions as well. I retired from IBM Security Systems just about a year ago to run the cybersecurity business at Micro. We've got a pretty good technical bench, and we've seen terrific success in the last year. What makes me fortunate is in this job, I get to talk to a lot of clients, people like those of you in this room, and what I hear a lot is a couple things. A lot of customers, I'm sorry.
Take the mic.
Oh, sorry.
There you go.
Thank you. Better?
Take your time.
Yeah, I don't know if it's on or not.
Is there any IT people in the room?
Yeah. Okay. Better. I'm not going to bother introducing myself. But the nice thing about being in this job is I get to talk to a lot of frontline customers, CIOs, CISOs, a lot of end users, and a consistent theme that I get a lot is a lack of insight. A lot of customers tell me, you know, I've got these solutions or those solutions, antivirus on the desktop, firewall, maybe IDS, maybe IPS, I've got good policies in place, but I don't really know what's working. And there's three questions I ask customers, and the conversation will be steered by what kind of answer I get. Number one, who has access to your assets, to your data? Number two, what can I do with it? Number three, can you prove it? And then in the last year or so, I added a fourth, the corollary, which is, how do you know? So who has access? What can they do? Can you prove it? Which, of course, is compliance. But the fourth one is, of those three, how do you know? And it resonates with a lot of people that don't have the insight as to what's really going on in their environment, whether it's desktop, endpoint, the core, the perimeter of the network. A lot of customers really, really lack insight. That's an issue.
Thank you, Tony.
Val Thomas, CIO for Lincoln Tech, trade skills school, about 30 campuses across the U.S., 15 to 20,000 students, depending upon the time of year, approximately 10,000 desktops out there. We have a for-profit, so I've got the educational institutions out there along with the for-profit and the regulatory type concerns that go along with that. So we're protecting my CFO as well as protecting all that student information as well. A lot of our concerns are around what happens with a breach, what's our risk to that, and then what's the danger of this. And I saw in the previous presentation around how that could affect our reputation, how that can affect our customer, and what can we do about that. So a lot of the questions, a lot of things I hope we can talk to about today to you is what we've been doing about that, how we're approaching that, what we can all think about as far as, where is this? It doesn't just stop with IT. I think everybody kind of knows that at this point. It's going to come back down to what is your total company policy and attitude towards security and where that goes.
Thank you, Val.
Yes, thank you. Jim Eichmann, CTO of BuildTrust. You can read about me and my bio in the book, but I just want to tell you, what keeps me up at night. So at BuildTrust, we have a lot of customer data. We have invoicing statement data of public companies, large private companies, and all of that data that we're protecting on our side is important because anybody who looks at that data can understand how a financial portfolio for a company is doing, how they're invoicing or how much money they're collecting, can they trade on that information. We have their end users, credit card information, their ACH, their banking information. And I worry about that. I worry about all that information. We've not seen, the last breach in our industry. I don't want to be the next breach. Our clients don't want us to be the next breach. So we need to think about that data. We need to think about the governance of that data. How does it flow through our systems? Are they confident enough that we can protect that data? It all starts, from my point with the engineers, right? What are they doing? How are we training them? Have we put enough controls in place? Have we changed the mindset of our users, my users, which are all the engineers when they're developing all this software? It's great that, we have enough of the infrastructure in place with the WAVs and the firewalls and the intrusion detection. But for me, it has to be a discipline for my users, the engineers, to be able to say, I'm going to code something this way. I'm going to think about passing it to QA another way. I'm going to think about, how does infrastructure build into my application? How is it that my SDLC no longer works? We're now using a secure SDLC, and that's important for us. It's important for us to be successful.
I'm Nathan Horn Mitchell, I'm the Information Security Officer at the Provident Bank. So we're the oldest bank in New Jersey, have about 90 locations around the state. We just recently moved into Pennsylvania. So what keeps me up at night is the data that our bank owns. It's customer information, both individuals, small businesses, larger businesses. But for me, the way I think about it is, and this is something that we stress to all of our new employees, with a data breach, depending on your street, there's a level of forgiveness. So I'd venture to say that almost everyone who was compromised at Target has probably stepped foot inside a Target again. But it's not the same for your financial institution. So as I always tell our new hires, we get exactly one shot. Because the minute your bank breaches your data, you find a new bank and you never come back. Not only that, you tell everyone you've ever met how terrible that bank was that lost your data. So the threshold or the margin for error for us is much lower than any other industry. So what I really focus on, especially with a bank where you have tellers who touch people's information on a daily basis, is let's focus on our people. There's a lot of great security tools out there. There's a lot of great security technology. And yes, you need to put that investment there. But if you're not putting that same energy and investment behind making sure your people understand the risks, understand their responsibility, that the value of the information they're touching daily, that's when you're going to run into problems. And in my world, that's when you don't get any forgiveness.
Thank you. Appreciate that. So, you know, I wanted to start with a few questions for the panelists, and then we'll reach out to the audience. So, and get you a little bit more engaged, you know, as we have this discussion, because it's really what we want here is a discussion. So what I'd like to start with is, you know, I talked a little bit about the changing threat landscape. You know, and I'll tell you, one of the things that we talk about a lot, and you read from Forrester and Gartner and everybody else, is security breaches are inevitable today. They're going to happen. And you heard Perry's comments, you know, what Director Comey from the FBI said. You know, there are the companies who know they're compromised and the companies that don't know they're compromised. And that is the world we live in today. I mean, you can buy a lot of technology, but there is no silver bullet. You can only shrink that window of exposure, identify the attack when it happens, so, and try to push them right back out of your network again and close that hole that was there. So, you know, for the panelists out here, and I'll toss this one out to everybody, you know, related to that, how do you feel the security landscape has changed with some of the recently publicized breaches? And how has that impacted you and your organization?
Well, I'll start. Obviously, it's bringing awareness out amongst the organization. Before, you know, security was this IT thing. Let IT worry about it. But now we're seeing, they're just, you know, maybe the sky is falling or crying wolf or yeah, you just want more money. I'm taking some extremes here. But at the same time, now they're seeing what the total impact is. Now, you know, we're seeing what could happen to an organization and what could happen to your company. And, you know, as we look at this, as we go down the years, and I look at the, you know, the past few years here, I know our security stance from the non-technical person, they've gotten more savvy. They've gotten better at not responding to the spam or giving you a free iPad and things like that. So it's actually, I think, helped us to a certain extent more than anything else. Now, has it raised sleepless nights and things like that? Perhaps. But I think it's really getting the awareness out there, so when we start talking about security, people are actually listening.
Anyone else?
So I think building upon that statement, I don't think the security landscape has changed all that much. I think people's awareness of it have changed, and people outside of the security and technology space. So now you have to have a good answer when you go present to your board. You have to be ready to talk to your executive leadership team on a fairly, often basis about what's going on in the industry and how that impacts what you're doing internally at the organization. So I think the biggest thing that has changed now is people's awareness. You're getting customers who are more aware, you're getting executives who are more aware, you're getting the security message you have to present outward as opposed to just inward. I think Unity Bank actually is running a commercial right now where their CEO is telling people not about how great the bank is, but that they should only be using their online banking password for their online banking. They shouldn't use anywhere else. That's their entire commercial, and then it goes to their logo. That's a commercial that never would have existed 2 years ago.
That's a great point.
So just quickly, if you're not tricking your employees every year, you should. And I say that because there's awareness now, but I don't think it's getting any better. And I say that because we do this every year to our company, whether it's we send them spam and say, hey, the network went out, please send us your user ID and password, so by Monday morning you'll be okay. We'll buy a new company and we'll say, hey, go to this website and put your information in and you'll be able to view all the details about the new company. We say, hey, we're running a charity, please enter your credit card number in here, you know, it's for the president of our company and it's a worthy cause. So we trick them every year and it doesn't get any better. Right? We're still getting the same people over and over again entering their network password in, their credit card number in again. Try it. You'll be surprised. I was surprised. I would think that, you know, everybody in our company goes through security training every year and they sign off every year. They've been through security training. I sit up there and I preach to them and our numbers have not gone down of the tricks that we've done. So I don't think it's getting any better. It's certainly going to get worse in the industry before it gets better with high-level attacks. But we're trying.
I appreciate that. I want to jump to another one then. So related directly to what you said, you know, users are often considered the largest part of the problem for a security team. You know, how do you ensure users are part of the solution versus part of the problem?
Well, from, from our standpoint, talking to customers, yeah, to echo what Val, Jim, and Nathan said a moment ago, our job, collectively, all of us, the suppliers, the providers, users, customers, our job is to push that perimeter, the border out as far as possible to the end user device, to that whatever the node or the terminal happens to be. So a big part of it is user education. I like the idea about baiting your users that I haven't seen, but it's certainly novel. But I'm disappointed it doesn't work as well as you probably want it to. But that goes to show, you know, the users are not getting any smarter, right? So our job is to help mitigate the problem. So our mission is to push the border out further, push that border out as far as possible. But the good news is there are solutions in place that will help blunt or mitigate the user fat fingering or being the victim of a spear phishing attack. There are a lot of solutions in place that will prevent a lot of the breaches we've heard about in the last couple of years. Most of those were, for the most part, low-tech attacks, really prosaic technology, you know, low-tech type of warheads and payloads, with the exception of maybe something like Stuxnet, which was a very, very high-tech attack, extremely sophisticated, and probably indefensible. But most of the attacks that have made the press in the last couple of years probably could have been very well defended, had some simple measures been taken.
Yeah, and we've discussed that one a lot, and that one's very, very interesting because people often ask, why wasn't that more sophisticated? And it's like, well, if the screen door is open, nobody's going to go over and try to cut the alarm, right? So you don't need to. You just come on in. So you had something to add, Val?
Oh, sure. I mean, what I would suggest is, you know, to make this aware to your team, to your employees out there, is similar to what we're doing. We've got hotlines and email hotlines, I'll call, for any kind of phishing attack out there. Forward this on, so let's find out about it. People love to forward these things. A little aside, I don't think you even need to trick them. We sent out an email recently reminding people not to respond to any emails asking for usernames and passwords. Guess what kind of replies we got back? Okay, so they don't even read those emails sometimes, but you can see what your population might be like sometimes. But again, it's a matter of getting them involved, as you said, and letting them help check those front lines for you and make sure that these things that are coming in, you're knowing about it. If you don't know about it, you can't do too much about it. And you should be surprised at things that come in that you've never seen before when you have a large population of users.
Thank you. You had something to add?
There's something that we did recently. We completely revamped all of our employee security training, especially for new hires. And we spend about an hour with them, but we take the first 45 minutes and don't talk with a single bit about security at the organization. We talk about how they can improve their own security posture at home, how they're making sure they're protecting their own information, their own social security number, their own passwords, etc. And then when we make that transition into what they need to do from a corporate responsibility, we make this point. If I tell them personally, if I can't trust you to protect your own information, there's no way I can trust you to protect our customers. So I give them all homework. I said, look, tomorrow, when I come back in, I expect all of you to have unique passwords for every site. I expect all of you to know what accounts you have. I expect all of you to know what security questions you need to change, and all of these little simple things that gets them in that mindset of, my information is valuable to me, and I don't want to lose control of my own identity. And then when I come to work, I am a stopgap to protect thousands of people from potentially losing their identity.
Thank you. Appreciate that, Nathan. You know, and I'd add one thing. You know, in Silicon Valley, we're starting to see a few companies that are really taking an HR system and turning it on its head for cyber. I don't know if anyone else at the panel or in the audience has seen it, but there's a company that actually does an incentive for teamwork. So you contract with this company, and they provide an infrastructure for you where you help this team and somebody recognizes you, they give you points, you can go buy a new set of headphones or something online, whatever you'd like to do. But it's incentivized for good behavior of the company. So an aspiring CISO actually took that program and applied it to cyber. So it's a fascinating presentation where, you know, suddenly people are catch somebody piggybacking on a badge. So somebody doesn't have a badge, they stop them, they challenge them. So when it was part of the security team running the test, and guess what? That person just got points and got recognized at the company for doing something right. People that when they're spearfished, you know, at a company, when the company's running a test, somebody that catches it and reports it following the proper processes actually gets rewarded for it. So when recognized, you know, across the company. So it's very, very interesting, and it's been very successful for these couple of companies that have tried it. So, and you know, don't know if anybody has tried it out here on the East Coast. I've only seen it at two companies out there, but it's, I think, an interesting way to flip this on its head, since we all think that, you know, it's hard to get users even to sit through, you know, your yearly cybersecurity training once a year, you know, just to be aware of the do's and don'ts. But to incentivize them, I think, can turn this thing around. So I'd like to ask one more question, and then we'll take it out to the audience. You know, as companies grow organically, you know, or through acquisition, so some policies that work very well for a small company no longer work well at a large company. And in cyber, that can be very, very important, especially when you've got acquired assets you're bringing in. So any of the panelists want to actually talk about that and the challenges you've seen and had in that area and how you've responded to them? Nathan?
Sure. So we recently acquired a small Pennsylvania bank about a year ago. And organizationally, they're much smaller than us, much less mature. And one of the challenges that we really had was changing that kind of culture of openness that they had to being a little bit more rigid, a little bit more structured. There's more regulators involved with the size of our organization, especially now that we're combined. So for us, it was really, we spent a lot of time walking through and understanding all of their existing policies and all of their behaviors and their culture from a security perspective. And we did that long before the merger. So we identified what we thought were going to be major pain points. And we worked with their executive leadership team to be the bearer of bad news, for lack of a better phrase. So that the message was coming not from the new company that bought you and is bossing you around, but from your existing leadership team. Look, it's a different ballgame now. We're a large organization, and some of the things we did before we can't do anymore. So for us, we really look to partner with their leadership team from the get-go, because it's always a rough transition when you're from a company that's being acquired and being told what you can't do when you used to be able to, can be a place where people openly try and break the rules because they're concerned about their future with the organization.
Thanks.
So one of the things I do is when we go through an M&A event is I don't ask how good their security is, I ask how bad their security is. And I do this because, you know, when you're buying smaller companies, and especially companies that come from, you know, a family-oriented company, a lot of times there's a tendency to get the job done, right, to get the business, to grow the business, and, you know, the culture of security just isn't there. So is it, do they have enough discipline, you know, in product development, in moving things to production? Is the network wide open, you know, for individuals? Are items at rest, too long at rest? Do they have things at rest where it would be compromised if they come in, you know, through the front door or something, into the firewall? So I kind of flip that on its head and ask the question differently, because just in my experience, I find the companies that we purchase, the small companies that we purchase, it's not always in the forefront of their thinking.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that. But I've got really two organizations going on. I've got an administrative organization that's running the business, and I've got education going on. And with the teachers out there and the instructors out there, it's a bit more open. They want this openness, and they want this ability to just do whatever they need to do at a moment's notice. Where on the other side, we have to protect confidential information. So some basics that I think everybody knows is just, you know, segregation of the network, segregation of the data, segregation of the job functions within there, and being prepared to run those couple of different organizations that you have there. As we're acquired, we've done some acquisitions in the past, and as we do that, it is pretty much the same thing, taking a look at what they've got, how bad their security is, but then the policies themselves. We've grown significantly in the past 10 to 15 years, and the policies had to grow with them. They have to be revisited, and they should be revisited every year, if not more often, especially now. We came out with mobile device management. We had to go back and look at that. Our students start bringing laptops in. We had to go back and look at that, and you can't just wait. You have to be proactive. I guess that's the common sense thing I'd say.
I don't envy you on that one. So, you know, running a university or student environment, you know, if you listen to the students, you'd have a petri dish for malware. So that's what you have. So no easy task.
We have something called the Red Network.
Okay. It says it all. So I'd like to take some questions from the audience. So before we, you know, jump back into mine. Yes, sir.
Yeah, obviously users are always going to be challenged, right? But we obviously need to kind of do the right thing and need to grow what they need to do. So let's just put that on the shelf for a second. Here's my question. I think the SECs, you can create large, well-funded companies
we're putting three bad code out there and a few amount of vulnerabilities out there that people are going to backdoor into. Technology gotten more too complicated for technologists, the average technologist today. And as we move into the, as Val mentioned, move into mobile, that concern grows. So I just want to hear your opinion on that.
Yeah, I just had this conversation with my CEO yesterday, in fact. And, you know, so I'll date myself, but back when I was working on a VAX for an engineering firm, I knew everything about the IT in that firm. I knew everything. Communications to the systems, to how the disk worked, to whatever it might have been. There's no way any single person can do that. And it has become very complicated. That front-end system, these iPads and things like that, have made it much easier for the users to consume this technology. But the back-end has become much more complicated, as you said. Part of it is understanding it. Well, I'm taking the approach of being able to know what's happening, is awareness of what's happening. What's the proper behavior and what's abnormal behavior? And abnormal behavior doesn't necessarily mean that it's something bad going on, but it's something you need to look into. I think that's kind of the approach we're starting to take now around detecting bad things that are happening out there. I hope that helps.
It's a complicated question, and I will tell you, you know, my personal opinion is if you look around this room, you know, in the devices that people have, and if everybody booted up and compared notes on what applications you're running, what operating systems you're running on mobile devices, tablets, and laptops, you'll find there's millions of lines of different code right here alone in this room. So my point is, sir, and the way it's relying on today, that genie's not going back in the bottle. This is not going to happen. So it's something we're going to have to deal with. Is something to add?
Yeah, so just real quickly, you know, back when I was interviewing for jobs, you know, they're pretty complex questions as far as, you know, coding. I can't ask those same questions today that I was asked, you know, coming into the workforce. Kids don't understand what it means to have a stack overflow. They don't understand what it means to overwrite a buffer, right? So all these, you know, GLs that they're writing against, all the UIs, it's a different, you know, class of people who want to produce these, you know, great looking apps. So, you know, we've taken it upon ourselves to teach them what it means to be a secure programmer, right? What it means to, you know, have SQL injection, what it means to, you know, go through the OWASP top 10, right? What it means to be, you know, a security person in your field, because there are just, it's so easy nowadays to write, you know, in scripting languages, you know, to exploit these vulnerabilities. We have to take it upon ourselves, again, because these kids just don't understand, you know, those low-level concepts is what I've found.
You know, that's fascinating and so important that we've got executives actually pushing that down, you know, on users and, you know, coders in the company. Today we have so many universities across the United States and around the globe that have secure coding initiatives. So, and that's fantastic and can help tremendously. However, the impact of that is likely 5, 10, 15 years down the line, you know, before we start to see more secure code, and only successful if everybody around the globe starts implementing it, because code's developed in China and India and, you know, pick a nation out there. So it's very important from every one of our levels that we actually push that out. Any other questions from the audience? Yes, sir. Here in the front right.
Hey, how you all doing? Thank you for being part of this panel. It's important to all of us. Before you start laying foundations for security and trying to secure everything as a whole, it's best to figure out and value the company's assets and prioritize them in order to make sure that what you find is most valuable is protected the most. What group or what representatives do you use in order to prioritize these assets? Do you go with an executive group? Do you go by department? Do you throw a net out for a wide array of people from end user to executive? And what have you found to be the most successful ways to do so?
Okay. Well, I think you go with the, you know, it's a top-down type organization. Top-down type project and pressure has to come from there on the importance of something like this. So you have to start there. Now you're going to have, you know, what affects your business? What, if someone breaks into my systems and learns that, I'm trying to think of something trivial, I don't know, gets my email history. Not nearly as important if they break into my systems and get all my student information. Okay, so prioritizing it like that, I think, is what you're asking. Where do you go for that? So I don't have a good answer for you, but I'm trying to think, it should be fairly obvious, shouldn't it? I mean, when you still want to start splitting hairs, then, you know, maybe you get the different people involved. You might have a bunch of people shout that theirs is the most important, but everything can't be the most important. mindset. We have layers of security. I've seen that described a lot more lately about the onion layers of security, where you've got your most important stuff at that kernel, but it's not just this balloon shell. Like, once it's popped, everything's open. So where do you put those different pieces of information, I think, is what you're asking. Who decides that? You and the business. You as the CIO, the business as the owners of that information. Things would be different for each company.
I'd agree. As we talk to C-level execs, it's line of business driven, and the data owner or the asset owner is the arbiter of that decision, right? And what we've seen in the last couple of years, maybe 2, 3, 4 years, is this movement to the crown jewels approach. For maybe the last 10 or 15 years, we're going to tell the customers, you have to secure everything maximally all the time, period. You've got to build this 20-foot thick brick wall around everything. We can't afford to lose a byte of data, right? But now we're getting a little smarter where, you know, we're realizing, those of us in the industry and our customers are realizing, you can't do that. We can't afford to do that. You don't have the time, the people, the skills, the assets. So what are the crown jewels? What is at the center of that core, right? The stuff I really have to protect, and let's work our way out through the layers of that onion. There are some assets that don't require the same protection as student information, social security numbers, financial information. Other things, maybe the database of my product catalog. You know what? It's okay if that's at risk a little bit, maybe. But my financial information, certainly not. The stuff that is going to incur financial, certainly, or a legal liability. So that's something our C-levels tell us. Line of business driven, downward made decision, and certainly the segregation of the crown jewels, right? And apply various layers of protocols, policies, and protection to address the specific needs of those layers.
Thank you, Tom. Jim?
Yeah, I would just say briefly, if you don't have a master data management team or a data governance team, you know, get one. And get one very, very quickly. And each of those teams, they should assess where your data is going and what risk level you assign it to that data. It could be as simple as, we're sending our data to Salesforce. What does that mean? Well, you know, Salesforce had a breach a couple of years ago. It really wasn't well publicized, but some people's data, you know, went out. Is your ERP system in the cloud, right? So where is your data going? And then put a risk to that. You know, once you go through some of these, you know, audits, especially financial audits, you have to do a risk analysis of that data. And, you know, how do you act upon, whether it's credit card data, whether it's security data, whether it's HIPAA data, and who you have to inform. But if you don't have a data management team or data governance team, you really need to get one, you know, ASAP, so they can assign that risk level to that data.
You know, I couldn't agree more, and I will tell you, you know, a fascinating article last year. So when some of these major retail breaches took place, you know, there were a lot of boards that were interviewed, and I think it was actually the New York Times, and here's an executive from this board of directors that was talking about some of the most important things to them that most of us, not associated with that company except utilizing their product, would have never guessed. Well, the most important thing for us is how we put the curve in that Pringle chip. You know, it's in the newspaper. Who would think that was something that was critical to that business, was the manufacturing to actually do that? But again, it's actually, you know, having the team to actually go with the lines of business to understand what is critical in your organization. So from those lines of business, because quite frankly, unless you're living, eating, and breathing it, you may not understand it as a CISO taking over, you know, in new. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you guys very much for coming out. I have a question concerning the role that continuous integration and continuous delivery has sort of played in the software as a service space. And I'm wondering if you guys have had any, you know, sort of best practices or stories that you could share talking about the upside and the downside of both. Namely, has continuous delivery driven the proliferation of changes, or has it sort of come on the other side, changes force organizations to speed up their development cycles? Does that make sense?
I'm sorry, could you give me some examples?
Yeah, so if you see something like all the software as a service models that we all use on a regular basis, Gmail, Facebook, all like the consumer stuff that everybody's using, things are being changed and updated on a regular basis. There's no longer a monolithic release where you install a brand new thing and everything's different. Stuff is changing on a regular basis. So I'm sort of imagining both a scenario where you can use that process to address security threats in a more real-time basis, but at the same time, that threats are going to be coming into products in a more real-time basis. So I'm wondering, sort of, what's the upside, what's the downside, and how do you deal with that?
Thanks. Well, I'll kind of start. I mean, if you're talking about outside vendors doing all this, that's a big risk. And I think at that point, then, mitigate that risk with SLAs and security agreements with those vendors. I mean, everybody knows Target is infiltrated by a trusted vendor. That's how they got into Target. It wasn't a direct attack on Target. If you're talking about internally, then that's agile methodologies, and I think the security portions of your team, you need to put those as milestones or as deliverables inside that. And then I think that's a, I think you raise a very good point. I think that's a great way to turn around and give continuous improvement out there. We have some vendors out there. We use a company called Instructure. They give us a product called Canvas, which is our learning management system for all of our students, online learning management system. They're putting a build out every 2 weeks. And that's great, usually, until they don't do it well. But again, with them, there is an agreement in place that limits our liability, and they got to take it on the chin if there's a problem. I think you need to manage that appropriately.
So I love this question because I struggle with this exact same thing. And in our company, it goes in ebbs and flows where we say, let's roll 10 times a day so we can be so, you know, customer focused, you know, and be on top of our game until something happens, right? Until the shit hits the fan, and then you're like, let's roll once a month so we are pretty damn sure that everything that gets into production is fine. I would say that what has helped us is looking at your maturity level. Looking at your maturity level of DevOps. Are you in a good position to have things go from the developers to QA, you know, in a secure manner? Are you testing enough? Look at your DevOps, are you secure in having going from QA to roll into production, you know, successfully, that maturity. Is your rollback procedures mature enough, right? Can you go ahead and say, you know what, on a whim, if something is affected, we noticed it, you know, let's roll back. Do you have the appropriate testing levels at development, QA, and in production to be able to say, you know what, we've noticed this correctly, quickly, right away, we need to roll back. So if you're not mature, you're probably not ready for it, and I don't mean mature as in a large company, small company, I mean in those disciplines, then that's what you really need to focus on, to say whether or not you can, you know, do something quickly, you should slow things down. I don't think there's a right and wrong answer, and I think it's just your maturity level in those areas.
Can I ask you a follow-up just based on that? Automation being a double-edged sword, right? So how do you sort of incorporate automation into that?
So we do it in two levels. I mean, our engineers will, you know, have their unit tests and they'll put it into QA, it goes through automation series. Then after they get testing, it runs nightly, you know, through automation. And then once it goes into production, we do automation to make sure we didn't break anything in those three steps. So it's a key part for us. You know, but we have the commitment and the people to make sure that, you know, that's part of it. Again, and that's part of the maturity level of the whole process.
You know, and I'd like to add to that, while you're doing that, I mean, in today's threat landscape that we live in, especially when you're talking about SaaS services, you know, or anything, you know, with that infrastructure side where you're making that a platform and moving it out of your own environment, it's critically important that you either outsource or insource, you know, actually a threat expertise, so you're actually continuously hunting in your own environment, looking for those anomalies, you know, that people may not be aware of. Because many times when you roll out something brand new, you know, that's when you're most vulnerable. So a lot of people don't think about that. And I think we have time for one more question, Jim. All right, one more question. Yes, sir, in the back.
Yeah, going back to comments you made regarding passwords being a challenge and how do you manage your users using hacked passwords, if you were to have a choice, how would you address that specific problem? Try to close that risk that exists in cybersecurity, whether it's on the SaaS-based environment or any kind of environment. Their password time after time is becoming a big problem for people to deal with data breaches.
I think to start in an ideal world, I wouldn't rely on just a password. I think the password model is fundamentally broken. We want people to remember things that are long and complex, which by their very nature are hard to forget, or hard to remember. We want them to think of a bunch of unique things. I mean, there's password managers and other tools, but I think if we're solely relying on passwords, that's the problem there. So I think looking at other technologies, two-factor, device fingerprinting, a lot of other things that give you additional degrees of confidence that the person is who they say they are. I think that's where we're going to have to move and try and figure out how a lot of these older legacy tools are going to be fitted to work with a more intelligent authentication.
I'll just say I struggle with the same problem, the same question. And longer passwords that allow very long passwords, 18-character, 20-character passwords that are simple phrases. Don't worry about uppercase, lowercase, numbers under that. Just make it long and let them put spaces in their password. So cats dance at midnight on the river is a passphrase that someone can remember very, very quickly. They'll all complain about how long it is for their password, but they won't forget it. And it really takes, length is more important than numbers.
I just want to add, I think that there's, you know, a lot of technology out there today that's somewhat complex, somewhat difficult to implement, but it can take us there, and there's lots of research in this area that can help us. Whether you're using a new smart card technology with an iris scan or, you know, a retinal scan or fingerprint scan, there's a lot there that can actually come together. The problem today is, you know, when you're looking at your organizations, the cost has got to come down, as well as the complexity for implementing that and making sure it's secure. So I'd like to thank our panelists today. So thanks to NJTC.
Thank you, Tony. We're going to break for 15 minutes, so come back in your seats at 3:15 to hear Jack Harrington speak. Thank you.